military and our thoughts and prayers that they come home safe. Let's hope we have world peace and peace in our country and no hate. Thank you. What?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The notice of this meeting pursuant to the Open Public Meetings Act, NJSA 10:4-10, has been complied with and shall be entered into the minutes of this meeting.
Roll call.
Fielder Armwood.
Here.
Fielder Kenny. Fielder Cockle.
Here.
Fielder Nara.
Here.
Fielder Mara.
Here.
Fielder Valenti.
Here.
Fielder Director Rio.
Here. We have recognition.
We have one recognition this evening. It's recognizing Paul J. Sansone on behalf of Sansone Auto Mall.
Is there a motion to adopt the above recognition? Motion by Fielder Valente, second by Deputy Director Tamaro. Roll call.
Fielder Armwood.
Yes.
Fielder Cockle.
Yes.
Fielder Nara.
Yes.
Fielder Tamaro.
Yes.
Fielder Valente.
Yes.
Fielder Director Rio.
Yes. The representative, Mr. Dato, is here from Sansone, if you would come up. Mr. Bob Dato, who is the legal director for Sansone Incorporated, for Sansone Auto Mall. And we are recognizing Mr. Paul Sansone for all his efforts and what he has done. And he's really made a significant financial commitment to veterans. He has built a complete building for training veterans in the auto industry, whether it be sales, whether it be mechanical, whether it be for financing a car, whether it be for whatever part of the business, in the auto business, he created a training center for veterans. And he's been recognized nationally, not only statewide or countywide, but nationally as well. And he's being recognized this year in Las Vegas, Nevada, from the National American Legion for what he has done for veterans. And he has really set the bar high, whether it be for individuals or for corporations or anyone, how he has made the commitment for veterans. And everyone knows that myself and this Freeholder Board have been very committed to the veterans, and we really appreciate everything that Mr. Paul Sansone has done in promoting, training, and helping our veterans. So I'm not going to read all the whereas and therefores in this resolution, but I want to give this to Mr. Bob Dato to present to Mr. Paul Sansone in the at the convention in Las Vegas, Nevada. I wish I was going. Like to say a few words?
Please, it will be very short, I guarantee it. Much of what I was going to say has already been said. And so, as Ron detailed, the Sansone Veterans Initiative, as we call it at Sansone, it's one of a kind. And as such, we're so proud to be the recipient of the American Legion National Employer of the Year, to give you a sense of the significance of that. Of that honor, the last to be honored was Home Depot. And so it is of significant consequence that the American Legion has chosen Paul and the Sansone Auto Mall as the recipients of their national award. And although we'd like to go to Vegas, it's in Reno, so we'd be in the wrong town if we were off to Vegas. Close enough, Bill. I want to mention something that Ron did not, and that is that we have a very special program here in Middlesex County. And it really was put together under the auspices and direction of Freeholder Rios. It was he and I who met some months ago and talked about the opportunity to interview veteran inmates at your correction facility. You have a good number of veterans who unfortunately are incarcerated, typically for minor offenses, and particularly here at the correction facility where their stay is less than 1 year. And as they're become eligible for parole or release, we have the opportunity, our team, to visit with them at the correction facility, as we did not more than 2 days ago. And we are introduced by the warden and his team to those veterans who are incarcerated, who are going to need an opportunity to become employed. And so we lay out for them the San Selm program, and we explain to them that there are what we call shadowing or apprentice programs available to them, and it is that they should consider coming into the automobile industry, not necessarily San Selm. It could be sister dealerships, it could be competitive dealerships. We have a number of dealerships throughout the state who have joined us in this program. And so we interview the veterans, as we do periodically in your correctional facility, and we're bringing them from incarceration to having the wonderful opportunity to earn a solid living in selling, repairing, restoring, marketing. And there are so many businesses that are under one roof at an automobile dealership, much of which you are unaware. So with all of that, I said I'd be short. It's a little longer than I anticipated. Never trust a lawyer. I thank you for this resolution. I'll pass it on to Mr. Sansone, and we'll carry it with us to Reno when it is that we travel next week. Thank you again.
Scholarship award. So with that being said, we have from the Middlesex County Academy for Allied Health and Biomedical Sciences, we have Atul Bhatiprolu. If you would come on up, and we have a check for you, and we have a representative from Investors, if that representative from Investors would be here. How about NJAC? Okay. And I just want to say, Atul is graduating with a GPA of 3.87. He has been an active executive board member in the Middlesex County Academy for Allied Health and Biomedical Sciences, Amnesty International Chapter. He has spearheaded charities and sensitivity training as well as workshops at our school. Atul is a gentleman of character who can always be counted on to do the right thing. Atul will be studying public health with a long-term intention to become a physician. He is going to attend Rutgers University, and his intended program of study is public health. Atul, you make us very, very proud. You are an outstanding student. As I said earlier, you do the right thing, and I can't congratulate you enough. And appreciate what you have done. And we have also representatives. We have Diane Ballou, who is the assistant superintendent of the vocational schools, who will be the superintendent of schools for vocational schools as well. So congratulations.
On behalf of the NJAC Foundation Board, Investors Bank, we would like to congratulate you on this scholarship, and we thank you for your hard work and wish you much success in your future endeavors. Congratulations.
Anthony Seco, is he here? He hails from my town, Carteret. Anthony has achieved high honor roll every market period since his enrollment. He is ranked first in his class, and he is the valedictorian. Anthony is a member of the National Technical Honor Society and has participated in Skills USA competition. He has been named outstanding in shop in his career major. Anthony participates in the VidCast Club and the Volleyball Club. During his 4 years in electrical trades, Anthony has shown the ability to work independently as well as part of a team. He relates well to his peers and to faculty and staff. He will be attending our own Middlesex County College, and his intended program of study will be electrical engineering technology. Very, very impressive. We're very proud of you. Congratulations and good luck.
Have already enrolled at Middlesex County College to continue their educational journey. Other students have enrolled in vocational training programs, and some students have obtained employment. Congratulations and best of luck to these graduates. Weekly recruitments are ongoing at the Office of Workforce Development's Career One-Stop Center for employment opportunities with FedEx and Amazon. Both companies are hiring full-time employees for jobs at locations throughout Middlesex County. Text workforce to 56512 for the latest information about hiring events. A job fair has been scheduled for Thursday, September 14, 2017 from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Old Bridge Municipal Complex. The Office of Workforce Development is finalizing the list of employers that will be attending. The information will be posted soon on the county's website. Employers and job seekers interested in attending the job fair can call 732-745-3970. From the Office of Arts and History, a lecture with Master Gardener Stephanie Caroli on Magnificent Monarchs will be held this Sunday at 2 p.m. at East Jersey Old Town Village in Piscataway. This event is free of charge. Mark Heater and his band will perform music from the Great War on Sunday, August 27th from 6 to 7:15 p.m. at East Jersey Old Town Village in Piscataway. This event is free of charge. Bring a blanket or chair and come join us. Food trucks will be on site. From Rutgers Cooperative Extension of Middlesex County. On Saturday, August 26th at 10 a.m., a workshop on gardening in small places will be held. Call 732-398-5262 to register. The event is free and located at the Earth Center on Riva Avenue in South Brunswick. And that concludes my report for this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Fielder Armwood. Fielder Fielder Leslie Koppel.
Thank you, Freeholder Director. Tonight we just introduced the ordinance number 437. This ordinance funds the equipment portion of the county previously approved 2017 capital program. This is the annual program which funds equipment for the county and county municipalities that opt to participate. The equipment required for communications, hardware, and software, voting machines, and other election equipment, furniture, and vehicles. The equipment will be funded by the sale of bonds. The bond sale for this ordinance triggered a bond rating, and thus on August 2nd, Standard & Poor's once again assigned Middlesex County a AAA bond rating, the highest rating attainable. This rating is a direct result of county efforts to reduce overall debt and annual debt service. The county's net debt decreased by $190 million or 27% over the past 2 years. And since 2015, our annual debt service decreased by $13 million annually. With this affirmation, the county will have maintained a AAA bond rating for an unprecedented 16th year in a row. It is estimated that during this 16-year period, the rating has saved taxpayers more than $35 million. These savings are realized by borrowing funds at lower interest rates. They are also passed on to our municipalities that join the county's equipment purchasing programs. As an illustration of the savings, the county recently sold the bonds required for the introduced ordinance at a great rate of 1.605%. Without a AAA bond rating, the rate could have been 10 basis points higher. This lower rate will result in considerable savings for the life of the bonds for both the county and the participating municipalities. Fielder, that concludes my director. That concludes my report.
Thank you, Fielder Koppel. Fielder Shantinara.
Thank you, Director. The Divisions of Consumer Affairs and Weights and Measures, which protect residents from consumer fraud, have moved from 711 Jersey Avenue to 77 Apple Orchard Lane in North Brunswick. And since that's my hometown, welcome. This relocation of divisions is part of the county's cost-saving strategy by moving county offices from rental properties into refurbished ones owned by the county. The new telephone numbers for these divisions are as follows. Weights and Measures can be reached at 732-398-2307, and Consumer Affairs can be reached at 732-398-2300. Residents can visit the new offices seeking personal assistance. This change, as well as other important countywide information, the phone numbers where they can be contacted, can all be found by visiting the county's website. And as a reminder from our Environmental Division, on August 26th, there will be another countywide paper shred event. This time it will be hosted by the Carteret Community Center, located at 100 Cook Avenue. This event is free to all county residents and will be from the hours of 9 a.m. to 12 noon. So you can come before or after and still make it to the Rutgers Cooperative for the gardening and small spaces session. Anyone who has any questions, you can call the Division of Environmental, the Environmental Division at 732-745-4170, or visit the county's website for additional information and the listing of all the other free residential services we have. And that concludes my report, Fiola Director.
Thank you, Fiola Nara. Fiola Deputy Director Charlie Tamaro.
Thank you, Director. And from the Board of Elections, two companies have met with the Board of Elections to demonstrate new voting machine equipment to improve voting experience for Middlesex County residents. Still in a discovery mode, the Elections Board has not made any decisions before the County Elections Board can choose which company to use. However, the vendor must go through federal analysis to ensure the integrity of the equipment. You must then present the results of the State Division of Elections to approve use of the machines in the state of New Jersey. The current equipment that is still used today will be used in this November general election. I will report on any progress made on this issue in future meetings. The Middlesex County Tamarack Golf Course in East Brunswick had a record number of rounds of golf played on this past Sunday, August 6th, with 402 rounds. It was the best in years. The MCIA, which operates the courses in the county, is introducing a new golf and stay program with special golf rates being implemented to encourage guests at area hotels to play at our courses. The program will be offered in the partnership with the Princeton Area Chamber of Commerce and the Middlesex County Convention and Visitors Bureau. And as you heard in previous meetings, we made significant improvements to all three of our courses. We had a new golf court fleets and have improved the fairways, the boxes, and the greens. We now have concession services in three locations for our golfers. These investments are attracting new and returning golfers. And I want to congratulate our former freeholder, James Polis, who's really done a tremendous job in improving our area golf courses. So come and visit our golf courses, and if you're a golfer, you'll truly see a great improvement in those courses and what has been done. Thank you, Director.
Thank you, Fiola Tamaro. Fiola Blanquita Valenti.
Thank you, Fiola Director. From our Office of Aging and Disabled Services, residents aged 60 and over are encouraged to sign up for the county's annual Senior Health and Fitness Walk to be held Wednesday, September 13th at 10 a.m. at Roosevelt Park in Edison. Along with taking a beautiful walk around the lake, seniors can participate in health screenings, learn about available local services, and enjoy entertainment in a box lunch. Registration is required and closes on September the 2nd. Seniors should contact their local senior center to sign up. Meanwhile, the George J. Orlowski Senior Center for Mental Health Care has been operating in the fee-for-service environment since January, and under this model is exceeding the projected level of quality mental health services to residents. As the summer comes to a close, the center is gearing up to offer several new therapy groups, including a bereavement group in English and Spanish for adults who have lost their parents, a play therapy group for children between the ages of 6 to 10, a new mother's group focusing on postpartum depression and related issues, and a group called Straight Ahead, which provides clients with information, skills, and encouragement to strengthen and maintain their recovery. This group for adults who are duly diagnosed with mental health and substance abuse issues. And that's the end of my report.
Thank you, Fiola Valenti. I just have a few comments to make. I attended last week the senior art contest at our Office on Aging holds, and I have to tell you, the works of art are tremendous, from our senior citizens, photography, watercolors, and oil paintings. It's amazing the talent that we have and how many of them are going to the state finals. So it's really encouraging to see that. I also attended along with all my colleagues, we all attended the county fair, which was another great success. Really fantastic what our fair association does for the county and how they put that whole thing together. And I'm sure the day after the fair is over, that they start working on next year's fair. So it was really a great fair to attend, a lot of fun. Too bad there was one rain out day, but the rest of the week people made up for it and they attended. I'd also like to introduce who is here in attendance, or who will be, I mentioned before, our new superintendent for our vocational schools, Diane Below. Please stand up, Diane. Brian Lachlan is retiring, and he made a significant changes there, positive changes. Each superintendent that we get, we always get better and better. So I want to just say to Brian, congratulations. Matter of fact, I was on the phone with him today, congratulating him and wishing him a great, healthy, happy retirement. And with Diane being the new superintendent, wish you well, and we're here to work together as partners, as we always done. Okay. Do we have any resolutions to be added?
There are none.
Any resolutions to be amended? Any resolutions to be held?
There are none.
Any resolutions to be voted?
There are none.
Okay, at this time, I would like to open up the meeting to the public on any resolutions listed. Please state your name, your address, and it's 5 minutes.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, members of the board. My name is Charlie Krasnell. I'm from New Brunswick. I'm the editor of the community newspaper, New Brunswick Today. It's a long agenda, so I'm going to try to get all my questions in as quick as possible. I'm going to want to find out about this 1239, the expansion of the East Jersey Old Town Village. That's a really cool place. I'd like to hear about that. I'm also going to want to know about 50 and 51, is the transfer of some roads, I guess, to the township of Woodbridge from the county. I'd like to understand what the reasoning is for that. 1255 is really important. This is regarding the oil tank plume in this site here. And I want to know about that because I know it impacts the potential for developing the former Farron parking deck. 1269, I'd just like to know about the arrangement with Rutgers for Johnson Park for football games, and whether or not anything's changing from what the normal agreement is. Just to you know, refresh my memory about what the if there's any money changing hands. I think it's great that the county is trying to lease less real estate and have its own spaces for what it needs, but I do see some lease agreements here. I'd like to understand the logic behind those. I guess the probation department's renting a spot on State Street. I don't know if that's the same one they have, you know, whether there's a plan to phase that leasing out. And the next one, or the next two, are for right on the very next block, Byard Street. I believe this building has been actually approved for...
What numbers?
1288 and 1289. So the prosecutor wants to rent it for 5 more years, but it's my understanding it's already been approved to be expanded into a residential building, and I just want to know if maybe they know something I don't know, or why they need that extra space. They have an office right in the same neighborhood, and you know, since we're trying to phase out the leases, I'd like to know why we're going to lease from that particular building at 96-100 Byard Street. Under workforce development, there's a few matters that involve New Brunswick I'd like to know about. 1305 is an agreement with the Board of Ed. And then I guess 1319 and 1323 are both agreements with the City of New Brunswick. I'd like to understand those. 1344 is a vendor that has a name change. I'd just like to understand what they're vending, what services. On the topic of the Juvenile Justice Commission 2020 Comprehensive Plan, Resolution 1356, I know there's a campaign that's been launched to close down the Jamesburg detention facility. I don't know if I'm using the proper terminology, but there's a campaign. Some people want to see that closed. I wanted to hear from the freeholders how you feel about it. I understand it's a state thing, but it's in our county, and I want to know how you feel. 1369, somebody's going to attend a class about responding to radiological and nuclear weapons of mass destruction incidents, and gosh, I hope that never comes in handy, but I will be asking during the public comment about one thing I think would be one of the best things we could do to avoid such a situation would be calling for the immediate impeachment of the president. So I'll ask you your opinions on that during the public comment. And then under the prosecutor's office, 1385, I'd like to know who is the Camden County police officer who's been hired by the prosecutor's office. I'd like to understand if there's any cost to the county for 1386, which is a two of the...
There's no cost to the county for that.
Okay.
I can answer that right now.
Okay, so they're going to pay their own way to get to the office.
They're PBA local.
The union's paying. Okay, thank you. And then the very last resolution I'd like to know about what these transparent ballistic protection barriers will be used for.
Which one is that?
1394, okay. Sheriff.
Okay, you've done that?
That's all.
Okay, let's go back and start off. The first one, 1239.
Yes, sir.
In 1239, everyone had shared early in June our art and history assessment and regional plan, and wrapping with that, this is a another extensive plan to understand opportunities for East Jersey Old Town Village and our historic site. So we'll be looking to build the strategic plan for how that can be extended for the county.
Excellent.
Can I just add something?
Yes, sure.
Mr. Crenville, also, I was tasked with Shaw to look at whether or not we can make that into a revenue generator to help with the upkeep, bring in revenue to the county. Save taxpayers money, look at bringing in restaurant facilities, etc. There were people there one time who looked to want to donate money, and we really didn't have a mechanism for them to support that area. So part of this plan is to also look at how we can make East Jersey Village to be sustainable financially and bring in revenue.
Director, I'm just going to add, we were, Freeholder Armwood and Freeholder Kenny and I were there on a visit. And just so everybody understands, because I know Freeholder Armwood just talked about like eating establishments, but everything that we were hoping would happen is going to be in keeping with the time period. And there were some really terrific ideas about like a restaurant where they could cook and make food that was made at that time. So that's what we're looking at, I think, is part of the plan.
Thank you. What was the next one? 1250 and 51. John.
Okay, those are our roads. It's really Main Street and Woodbridge, which is a county road, which there's a lot of activity that goes on for the township itself. So in order for them to be able to do that in a more effective way, we are providing them the ability to take over that road to be able to do things that are consistent with their master plans.
And Green Street as well?
Same Green Street. Okay. Next one is 1255.
Yes.
Oil tank plume.
During the course of the demolition of the Farron site, there was an oil plume that was discovered. And as part of the demolition and redevelopment, it's the county's responsibility to perform the remediation. And since this oil plume was discovered, it created an emergent situation in that the plume and the adjoining soil that was contaminated needed to be removed immediately. And the county engaged a vendor contractor to remove that soil, and this resolution just confirms the declaration of the emergency to arrange for the proper disposal of the contaminated soil.
So this was a couple months ago?
This was several weeks ago.
A couple weeks.
It's identified that.
Next one is 1269.
That is essentially the same program that allows the Rutgers football facility to use our facility for parking, but it's going to change in that they're only going to be utilizing buses instead of having cars come into that facility. So that's a fundamental change that the operating principle is the same.
Is there any money changing in this?
They do pay a fee in order to cover the cost of our rangers and park employees to maintain the facility. So any cost that incurred because they're utilizing it, they pick up.
Thank you.
1288.
And also 1287.
And 1287, 1288, 1289.
Okay, from a real estate holding standpoint, what we're trying to do is, as was mentioned earlier, we're saving over $100,000 a year by moving weights and measures over to Appalachia. Consistent with that, we always have to look for a facility that makes sense to move people into. In this case, when it comes to the probation department, which is going to the courts, these are facilities that have to be consistent with specific locations. So that's why we're continuing to lease exit serves that community. And the same thing applies, that's 1287. On 1288 and 1289 in particular, again, there are no other locations we can at this point put the prosecutor's operation, so we'll stay there. Not aware of any potential change where they're being expanded that site, but obviously we want to stay at this commitment because they're there today. If something changes where they're going to be selling the building or facility or enhancing it, then we obviously have to look for alternative locations. Unfortunately, we don't have all locations where we can bring our people in-house. We do that where we can, otherwise we continue to need lease space to achieve that.
Next one is
1305.
Right. Yes, I can answer that. Office of Workforce Development typically contracts with the New Brunswick Board of Education to provide services to camp recipients who are required to participate in job search and other activities. Traditionally, we've been doing that for many years because we have a one-stop center located in New Brunswick. We also see there's another resolution, 1306, which is similar for Amboy Board of Education for our Amboy facility. This is just extending the contract. Initially, we contracted with them last year. Our funding ended June 30th. We did not receive our funding in a timely manner from the state, so that original contract was extended for 2 months. And now we're just executing the contract for the remainder of this year, which started on July 1st. Thank you.
1319.
I can answer that.
Okay.
I'm in April 1319, and you asked about 1323 as well. One of the primary responsibilities of the Office of Aging and Disabled Services is to fund a network of providers to do services throughout the county for older adults. And they award their contracts at the beginning of the year based on an initial award from the state. About halfway through the year, we get a mid-year allocation, and then we extend those services through those additional funds. So that's the purpose of those two.
Just continuing.
Mm-hmm.
1344, the name change for the vendor
yes.
Name change?
This vendor is currently in contract with the county for our housing voucher program. They have changed their name, and consistent with our policy and procedures, I have to amend the resolution to reflect their new name. They also have to complete a W-9 to reflect the same.
Can I just ask how long they've been providing those services?
I don't know that off the top of my head.
They're a landlord under our housing program.
I see.
So they, North Brunswick Village of Shelter, probably been Jerry. Many, many years.
I'm sorry.
And 1356, Jerry, can you answer that?
Yes, that award is totally unrelated to Jamesburg, but if you want us to tell you a little bit about what that is for, we can do that.
Please do.
Melissa will do that. The plan that we're submitting to the JJC is for five service areas: the prevention, diversion, disposition, reentry, or with individuals once they leave Jamesburg and come back into the community, their services in place for them. And diversion, disposition,
prevention, reentry.
What was the last
part? Prevention. Is it prevention?
Yep.
Prevention, diversion, detention, disposition, or reentry. So it's detention alternatives that we don't need.
You got a shift from the freeholders about closing Jamesburg?
We're not going to discuss that. That's not in there.
Okay.
1369, authorized volunteer Robert Jolly from the OEM.
There's no question about that. I don't know. It's
1385.
President being a maniac.
1385.
I can actually speak to this. Mr. Cradiville, with respect to resolution 1385, there is a statute on point which escapes me at the moment that essentially provides that if a particular county sends an officer to the academy, and they leave that respective county within a certain period of time to join another police force or law enforcement agency in another county, the statute provides that the former county has to reimburse the, the new county for the training and the services that we've provided. And this resolution reflects a negotiated amount with Camden County for the services that were provided. So this officer was trained in Camden County, came to Middlesex.
Understood. I'm familiar with the statute. Can you just tell me the name of the officer?
I do not know the name of the officer.
Okay, I'll follow up. You already answered 1386. The only one left is the very last one.
1394. That one we will have to get an answer for you. Okay.
Those are the large, clear barriers that a sheriff's officer would hold in front of him for protection.
The riot shield?
Exactly.
Just tell me, how many?
That I don't know. I would have to get back.
Does the sheriff's department usually respond to situations where those would be needed?
The sheriff's office realizes that they may need it, so in partnership with other departments, I would imagine, so I guess that's why they're doing it. Anyone else in the public?
Good evening, my name is Tommy C. Flynn from the Township of Woodbridge. I'm the floodplain manager there. I just wanted to speak really quickly on 17-1278R for the incorporation of the guidelines for the CRS assistance program. I've had the pleasure of working in a variety of different counties over the years, and I've seen this program work very, very well in Monmouth County, and I'm just elated that our own county here is thinking about adopting that. I can speak to the fact that I was born and raised here in the county, and I've seen flooding all my life. This is just a wonderful program to look at reducing the risk to flood damage over time, increasing resiliency, and making good fiscal sense in the long run. The Township of Woodbridge has the highest number of flood insurance policies in the county. We pay astronomical ratables, just as a lot of other folks do in the county. So really what this program does, it's going to increase public information, interconnectivity across the county. It's going to be great for hazard mitigation planning across all sectors. And it just makes good sense as storm frequency intensifies, and we have to start thinking about these things happening more frequently over time. So thank you so much. Thank you to the county planners who have helped us make the decision already to move forward with the CRS program. And just thank you very much for allowing me to comment.
Well, it's just another program where we try to work together with the municipalities to make it obviously a lot easier for our residents to deal, especially with situations like that with floods and dealing with the insurance companies and all the maps. And so, yes, we
great. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in the public?
Move to close the public portion.
Second.
Motion by Deputy Director Tamara, seconded by Fielder Valente. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Motion is in order to adopt the consent agenda consisting of.
Excuse me, Fielder Director. I'd like to have one separated for
yes.
Separate vote.
Sure.
17-1341-R.
Anyone else have any?
I do. 1341.
Okay.
Director, motion is in order to adopt the consent agenda consisting of resolution numbers 17-1219 through 17-1394 and resolution number 17-1341 to be voted upon separately.
Is there a motion?
Motion.
Second. Motion by Fielder Valente, seconded by Deputy Director Tamara. Roll call.
Fielder Armwood?
Yes.
Fielder Cobble?
Yes.
Fielder Nara?
Yes.
Fielder Tamara?
Yes.
Fielder Valente?
Yes.
Fielder Director Rios?
Yes.
Director, it would now be appropriate to consider resolution number 17-1341, which was excluded by Freeholders Armwood and Valente.
Motion to adopt 1341.
Second.
Motion by Deputy Director Tamara, seconded by Fielder Koppel.
No, that's
me. I'm sorry, now my hearing's bad. Roll call.
Fielder Armwood?
Present, not voting.
Fielder Koppel?
Yes.
Fielder Nara?
Yes.
Fielder Tamara?
Yes.
Fielder Valenti?
Present, not voting.
Fielder Director Rios?
Yes. Okay, this time I'd like to open up the meeting to the public on anything the public would like to speak on. You state your name, you have 5 minutes.
Good evening once again, Charles Cradlin, New Brunswick. As promised, I'd like to ask if any of the freeholders have contacted either of the congressional representatives for this county about the dire need to impeach the President of the United States.
I've had numerous conversations with my congressman in reference to the President's policies that I am not in agreement with most, if not all. But that's something that they would have to take up, and I can't say that they're going to do it or not.
With all due respect, I've reached out to my congressman, and I'm going to continue to do that. I'm going to use my voice to try to get him to sign on to the existing article of impeachment that's already been drafted, already been introduced in Congress. And I would suggest that as the freeholder director, as the freeholders, your voice might carry a little more weight than mine. I hope that you will get on social media and reach out to the congressperson, or pick up the phone, or next time you see him, urge them to impeach President of the United States, because it's a dangerous situation. That is, the further it's allowed to go on, it's not going to end well. So let's get ahead of this, and you know, I don't see any reason why not at this point. So
make no mistake about it, I am not in favor of some of his rhetoric and comments, especially the way he behaved and reacted, or how long it took him to react on this past weekend. And this county has always been a very inclusive county. Our board is a very diverse board, and we believe in fairness and equality for everyone.
Then please, with all due respect, urge your congressperson to impeach the president. I'm going to say I'm disappointed that another meeting has gone by without the sheriff or the prosecutor here. They're both absent, and I've been copying Freeholder Now on some of my emails. I think there's a new person in charge of the press at the MCPO, and this new person is not sending New Brunswick Today, the community newspaper here, their press releases. I noticed in other outlets that they're looking for the public's help identifying someone, and they're not availing themselves of the resource that is New Brunswick's community newspaper by simply including us on their press release. And I've made 6 requests since this woman took over and have not gotten any response whatsoever. The last meeting, I brought up the fact that under the prior press person, they made false statements about the death of a man named Daniel Nakahama, and you know, I hope that you're looking into how those false statements were made and what efforts are going to be made to correct those false statements, and ensuring that whatever statements they put out, they send them to all the newspapers, and that they're true. I'd also like to know what happened to all the sheriff's officers that paid bribes to get their jobs under the last sheriff. It's my understanding that the police fire retirement system has found that a current officer, John Puppo, paid a bribe to get his job. I'd like to understand why he still has his job, and the other folks who paid bribes, I believe, were terminated. Another person who's not here is the undersheriff, who, as we reported more than a year ago, interfered with a warrant that was scheduled to be executed at his home. I think these are all issues that the sheriff herself should answer for, but in her absence, I'd like to hear from the freeholders who are her running mates and teammates in the same political party, and ultimately, if she's not here, I still need the answers about this. So I would like to know what happened to the sheriff's officers who paid bribes to get their jobs, and also what the heck happened with the undersheriff interfering with that warrant. And I'll just close by pointing out that the ethics board still has a long way to go. There is one vacancy on the board. There was a chronically absent member who I don't believe attended a single meeting in the time I've been attending, and he's no longer on the board, Reverend Martinez. So that means there's a vacancy. There's only 5 members instead of the full 6. And one of those 5 members was convicted of violating the local government ethics law at their most recent meeting. So you've got an ethics violator on the ethics board, and you've got one vacancy on the ethics board, and you also have their attorney, and this is really where the problem is. Anthony Vignolo violated the local government ethics law, but they didn't hold him accountable. They let him get away with it. And while the New Brunswick Ethics Board is investigating him, The Middlesex County Ethics Board continues to have Mr. Vignolo as their attorney, and I did get the most recent meeting on video. It was very short, and they weren't very thorough with their investigation, but you can watch, and you'll see the chairman of that board lie to my face. I was at this microphone, and I asked about the lack of them having sworn the oath of office. As you know, it's important. You're supposed to swear to uphold the Constitution and to do your duties faithfully and justly before you do those things. And none of the members that were present had done that. And I said, well, will you do it during this meeting? And he said, sure, we will. And then he broke his promise, all in the same video. You can watch it. He lied to my face. I think there's a big problem with the ethics board, and I would like to hear your response about the sheriffs.
Thank you. As far as the sheriffs, I don't know I don't know what the individual sheriff's officers, Popo, or the other sheriff's officers that you mentioned at this point. I could probably get you the information as much as I am allowed to, but that's all I can tell you at this point. I'll give you a truthful answer.
All right. I'll forward you the document from the PFRS, and I'll report your response. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in the public?
Motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
Motion opposed by Deputy Director Tamara, seconded by Phil De Valente. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. There are no